despite being one of the most hyped structure decks of recent years, the Monarch structure deck actually failed miserably at the very first event that it was legal at, mostly because it was against the full power Pepe deck. However, when the adjusted list came out, the emergency adjusted list, and it crippled most of the Pepe arsenal, Domain Monarchs and Extra Deck Monarchs became very popular, not only as a powerful counter to the best decks of the time, being Cosmo and Pepe, both of which Pepe lost to the Domain, Cosmo lost to Monarch Stormforth. It was also a budget option, which I think a lot of people really enjoyed. We haven't really seen a similar deck that was that cheap that's performed so well. The DDD structure deck, while good, required you to have a lot of other extra deck monsters and Pot of Desires. Where the Monarch structure deck, I mean, sort of similar to the Dinosaur structure deck, you could just put it together with three structure decks and play it in a tournament. Now, the Dinosaur structure deck, while good, also needed things like Dragonic Diagram to be fully, fully realized, fully powerful. And I'm talking about that because you all know that Monarchs, well, some of you might know that Monarchs is one of my favorite decks from last year. I liked trying so many different new things in there. The Brilliant Fusion Jax Knight combo was hilarious. I think it was such a cool way to play just a random level 5 light monster. And I really liked Monarch Stormforth when it first came out in Duelist Alliance. I played it in Battery Man. But Monarchs are interesting because despite... So you sort of have the two main variants, right? You had Domain Monarchs, you had Extra Deck Monarchs. But despite that, and despite all the cards being very meshable with themselves, we also saw some people splash them into other decks. I think the most notable deck that Monarchs were splashed into was Burning Abyss back when they had Beatrice. Well, I guess they still have Beatrice, but when they had three Beatrice. And that was for a lot of different reasons. Mainly that you could actually make Beatrice off of, if you lowered an Aether's level to level 6, and then with Domain, and then summon it, and then brought out the Karaz from deck, you could overlay both of those to just straight make a Beatrice. Beatrice could then be used defensively to send Farfa, or offensively to send Pantheism to the graveyard. And that was a really cool interaction. Not only did all those cards work together, the Burning Abyss monsters were very good starter cards and had a lot of longevity. Not to mention that milling cards was really good because you could mill Prime Monarch or Pantheism to the grave. She just gave you some truly absurd openings. However, on the ban list, that hurt Monarchs, which did three hits in one go, which, if you don't remember, it hit Aether, Pantheism, and Stormforth all to one. That sort of made them unplayable. Now, we've seen Monarchs pop up a few times at ARGs and regional qualifiers, mainly leveraging cards like Vanity's Fiend and Majesty's Fiend and Allure of Darkness to sort of turbo through their stuff, but it was nowhere near as disruptive or consistent as the pre-ban list Monarchs. However, I think that Monarchs as a strategy are quite interesting as a splashable engine. You have a lot of really powerful effects to work around. Both of the level 8 Monarchs, especially Erebus, now it's at 3, both of them have really good effects at not only dealing with your opponent's stuff, but also advancing your game state by loading up your graveyard with either Prime Monarch or Pantheism. Pantheism, in and of itself, is one of the most powerful draw spells ever released, not only getting you to two random cards, but also giving you a Monarch search. And Return of the Monarchs is incredible too, especially if you can get those tribute summons every turn. And there's a slew of other sort of sideline spells and traps that we've seen pop up a few times in other places, but they're just very good. And I think the most notable one here is the Monarchs Erupt, which has been very popular in Dracos recently. And that's actually what I wanted to talk about today in terms of the deck list. I wanted to mention that if you're trying to play Monarchs right now, if you're really sick of Zoo, but have some True Draco cards lying around like many of us do, I guess not everyone has True Draco cards lying around, but if you have most of the True Draco deck, if you've been playing Zoo True Draco but you're sick of it, I think Monarch True Draco or True Draco Monarchs, whichever one you want to emphasize there, is actually a pretty viable option. Now, I'll post a sample deck list on the screen right now, and what you can see here is that this deck has just mostly engine cards. I think the only It might just entirely have engine. Yeah, pretty much just it's either, if it's not a true Deku card, it's a Monarch card. And I think that's how this is meant to be built. I've seen some other lists out there play a Lore of Darkness, play Pot of Desires, play some other random stuff. But I think the way that this deck is meant to be built, at least in my opinion, is with just all true Deku and Monarch cards. And that's because both of those archetypes work best when you just see a hand full of them. When you see a hand, there's some really cool interactions here. So the main thing that I like is that the you can get the return of the Monarch's effect off of tribute summoning your true Dracos, and the true Dracos are a lot easier to tribute summon than the Monarchs because you can just tribute back row for them. That's really cool. Also, the anytime that you have like Masterpiece and Domain out, it's really hard for your opponent to deal with no matter what deck they're playing. Masterpiece in and of itself is already really annoying to deal with. If they have the Kaiju, they have it. But what's cool about this deck is that you get to see a lot of synergy between the tribute summon effects. So with your true Draco spells and traps, they're giving you an extra tribute summon. With your mini Monarch cards, the Knight cards, or Squire, sorry, they're Squires in the TCG, looking on Yu-Gi-Oh! Pro here, but the Squire cards give you the extra summons for the Monarchs, so you can do just a whole bunch of normal summons in one turn that are all just giving you so much advantage. And I think the ideal here is that your first turn, you're using Erebus to get rid of a card in your opponent's hand, and set up a Prime Monarch in your grave. And then also you're tribute summoning a Dynamite with a Domain on the field. Now this puts your opponent down to 5 cards when they start their turn because you've spun back 1. And also it puts them under Domain, so they have to deal with that. And also if they try to deal with Domain, you can just use your Dynamite Knight's effect to dig for a trap card. That trap card can then be activated to tribute for another true Draco in your hand, like a Masterpiece to pop a monster. It just gets out of hand very fast. One of the things that I liked about Monarchs, and a lot of people liked about Monarchs, is that it gets to a point when you just can't lose the game. It's a little bit harder nowadays because we don't have 3 Pantheism, but it gets to a point, and especially with the True Dracos as well, where you just have so much advantage, so much momentum, that your opponent actually just can't beat you. It'll get to a point in this deck where you have a Dynamite Knight on the field and maybe an Erebus, and you have the return up and you have the Domain up. You have a Prime Monarch on the field where you're just drawing a card every turn and recycling. Maybe you have an Escalation of the Monarchs in there. Maybe you have a Monarch's Erupt to stop effects, and your opponent just can't win the game. There's nothing in their hand that they can do to out it. There's not really a lot of mass back row protection right now that would actually just out everything. There's no Heavy Storm. Even a Twin Twister is, or a Cosmic Cyclone, would only out one of the threats, and I think that's really cool. Your monsters are huge, so that's definitely an issue for your opponent, and you're just with the... So the best way to beat Monarchs is just burn them through their cards. However, in this build, with the True Draco, specifically Ignis and Dynamite, your opponent, if they're burning through your cards, you're actually just gaining more card advantage, because you're just activating the spells and traps straight from the deck, and that's just really silly. So your opponent might invest their entire hand to deal with like Domain, or maybe they're gonna take a -1 to get rid of the Masterpiece, but then you have all of your spells and traps to just give you that advantage again, and then your opponent is once again locked down. I also really like March of the Monarchs in this deck, although I will say that March of the Monarchs is a little bricky. This deck in general can be a little bricky if you don't see your starter cards. However, I think that March of the Monarchs is worth playing because so you can get to a point where you have a Masterpiece that you tribute summoned using a monster and a trap card and then activate March of the Monarchs. So then now it just protects it from like anything, because now it has a spell trap and monster protection. Board wipes aren't going to kill it, nothing like that. That's just really unfair, really silly, and I like it a lot. But what's cool about this deck, other than what I've already mentioned, is that you very likely have all these cards lying around. And now I don't want to assume too much, but the deck, besides the diagrams, which by the way aren't very expensive anymore, but besides the diagrams, you basically have everything that you need right in a Monarch structure deck. Masterpieces are not expensive at all. None of the Monarch stuff is expensive. And I mean, a lot of people are trying to get rid of this stuff anyway, the True Draco stuff, because they think it's going to get hit on the ban list. And you don't, the other really important thing here is that you don't have to pay for an extra deck. So that makes it a lot easier. You don't have to pay for any Zoo cards. Don't pay for Lightning. None of that stuff. You can just play it without an extra deck, lock your opponent out of the game, and they'll rage over it. I think this could be a viable option, especially if we get to a point where, like, Diagrams hit to one and Masterpieces hit to one, and you need something else to fill out the deck with. You could play some more draw power with, like, Card Demise or Desires, or you could just play the Monarchs and give yourself an alternate win condition, which I think might actually be the superior way to go. And I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised to see this deck do well in regionals, depending on how the ban list works out, because it really doesn't rely on either engine too much. They both just sort of synergize and give you more advantage, lock your opponent out of the game in two different ways, either with Domain or Masterpiece, and it's just really silly. So anyway, hopefully you guys enjoyed this deck discussion. Let me know if you think Monarchs can be splashed into anything, or if you have splashed them in anything. I'd love to see what crazy things people have done. I think the craziest I've recently seen is on Zodiac Duel. Someone was posting their 60-card Monarch Lightsworn deck, which maybe was a little too far-fetched for me, but hey, it's whatever. Anyway, though, I'll see you guys later. Bye.